Yesterday was would have been Del Close's birthday. He was born March 9th, 1934, and he died March 4th, 1999. He appeared in a bunch of feature films, and I'll just read them here. American Graffiti, Thief, Ferris Bueller's Day Off, Light of Day, which I didn't know, and that cracks me up. The Big Town, The Untouchables, The Blob, the remake, Next of Kin, Fat Man and Little Boy, and The Public Eye. Also, Del appeared in the remake of the original Blob, Son of Blob. But he loved the stage. He was Polonius in the 1985 Wisdom Bridge production of Hamlet, and he won the Joseph Jefferson Award for that. He also was in Picasso at La Pine Agile, You Can't Take It With You, The Time of Your Life, Pal Joey, All's Well That Ends Well, and The Merchant of Venice. And I believe I was in his class when he was in The Merchant of Venice, and he said, please come see me if you can afford it. I'm kicking some Shakespearean ass. He is the co-author with Charna Halpern and Kim Howard Johnson of Truth in Comedy, which I'm sure everyone here has read and memorized. He had a spoken word comedy album, How to Speak Hip, which you can now order online. He even wrote, and my first exposure to Del was in the DC comic book's horror comic book, Wastelands, which is very cheap at the moment. You should buy him in the back racks. In a bio for his last Second City show that he directed, he wrote, this is the first Second City review Del has directed sober. He hopes it doesn't show. Of course, how we know Del, and I know Del, is in that metal box up there. He was cremated, and his head is at the Goodman Theater, and his ashes are here, where he watches over the work of long-form improvisation, where his theory that improvisation is not just comedy, it's theater and an art form. That was his idea. And tonight we have three very special guests. We have people who worked with him the longest and knew him the best. Charna Halpern, Noah Gregopoulos, and Jeff Griggs. All three of our distinguished panelists have been subject to Inside the Improvisers Studio before, except for Jeff, who refuses to do one. I guess we'll go in order. We'll go with begin with Charna. I know you've told the story before, but we thrill to it every time.
Order.
Yes. will you tell us how you met Del the first time?
The long version, the short version. Okay.
Whatever you want.
Okay. It's funnier version is the longer version. But basically,
be the not funny version.
Okay.
I'm glad you stayed.
I met him a long, long time ago. I had heard of him, and he had heard of me. And at the time, there was no such thing as long-form improvisation. I was doing the Improv Olympic, which was just games. It was kind of like comedy sports or theater sports, because that's all there was. And I saw him in an art gallery where he did this thing called the invocation, which appeared to me that he was invoking demons. I thought it was pretty scary. I was into meditation at the time, and white lading yourself and protecting yourself from spirits and everything. And I went up to him and told him that he had a lot of nerve doing that because people weren't protected. He told me he protected the whole building. And I said, you can't do that. He said, yes, I can. And I just walked away in a huff. And then about a month or two later, I had heard he left Second City. And I saw him at Crossroads, which is where the Improv Olympic was going on at the time. And about that time, I was pretty bored with the Improv Olympic as it was, because if I saw one more little gibberish translation game or whatever, all these little games, or I was going to puke. Even though the shows were successful, I particularly was bored, and I thought there's got to be something more for improvisation. And I went up to him, and I didn't think he'd remember me, because he was famous for not remembering students, just as I am today. And I said to him, how would you like to make $200 and some pot? And he said, doing what? And I figured pot would be the thing to get him. And I said, doing one three-hour workshop. I just figured if I could see something, maybe there's something I could steal or learn. And he said, can I do anything I want? And I said, yeah. He said, can I invoke demons? And I was like, he remembers me. So I said, yeah, you can invoke demons. You can do whatever you want. And he did an amazing workshop. And I gave him his $200 and some pot. And we went out for coffee afterwards. And I said, gosh, there's got to be something more than this. And he said, oh, well, you're not a twit after all, because he just thought that, you know, short form was nothing interesting. And he said, if you want to work with me and close down the Improv Olympic for a little while, and we could change the face of improvisational comedy and do something that I've been working on since the 60s called The Herald, which is basically unteachable and unplayable right now. And I said, yeah, let's do that. And we shut down, and then a few months later, we had our first Herald team.
Can we ask questions along the way?
Sure.
Do we have?
Yeah,
go ahead. So you said that long-form improvisation didn't exist at the time that you started working with him in, like, 81? And then you just said he'd been working on the Herald since the late 60s.
He had been working on in his private workshops with the committee in the 60s.
Which is?
What?
So Ms. Helper.
It was not.
Were you lying when you said?
Actually, it's a question in his workshops with the committee in San Francisco.
It's something that means Chief worked out earlier. Pretend to step on his tail, and he pretends to be a dog. Guinea pig with a dog.
In answer to your question, in the 60s, Bordeaux was working at Second City. He was directing a group called The Committee, where he had been experimenting with this thing, this long-form thing that his piano player called Harold, as a joke, and it became his, the name of his lifelong work. But it wasn't anything that was happening on stage, and it didn't have any form. It just went on and on and on forever, and it wasn't very successful. In fact, when we told some people that he knew from back then that we were doing Heralds, they went, are you crazy? That thing never works. And it was with me that we decided to, like, take one of the Improv Olympic games called the Time Dash and make a three-part scene. So we gave the body of the Herald. We took one of my openings, like a pet peeve rant, and made it into just a monologue opening, closer, put games in the middle, and we created this thing, and I brought it to the stage.
Okay, so let's just be honest.
I'm being honest.
You
don't
really
step on my dog.
You really emphasize me and I. And that.
I didn't know this could be about me.
Well, you wouldn't let us do that roast at the 20th anniversary. Well,
your head is still attached to your body, so. It's like William Wallace. You
what,
know how
did
they tore him apart, no. Put him in different parts of England so that he couldn't, like, come back to life? I think that's what we did with Dell.
The heads are Steppenwolf, the bodies are here. They can't get them close to each other.
That's what he wanted.
And then part of him is inside Melanie Blue's. Melanie Blue was a performance artist who ate part of Dell's ashes on stage.
Yeah, snorted
kind of
snorted him.
But he said, give me some of my ashes. I only did what my partner asked.
My favorite part about the Melanie coming and sniffing Dell's ashes is that...
And everyone has a favorite.
Yeah, I do. That's how she met him. She was doing a one-woman show, and it was her dead husband at the time, and she was wearing, like, piece of his... He had died, and he was cremated, so she was wearing piece of his pelvic bone that wouldn't burn on a necklace, and the whole show was about the dead husband, and she sniffed some of him, and then injected some of him.
It was your dead heroin addict,
yeah.
AIDS dead husband,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, and Dell saw the show and said, well, that was wonderful. And
he liked weird people, you know, that's why we're all out there. He liked
so that was like her catchphrase, eating dead people's ass.
That's her bit.
That was her stick lady.
It was actually worse than that. She said she had to put her husband's ashes somewhere, and she said, where was he happiest? Inside me. I forgot to get up. Let's get back to Bell.
Melanie, come on out.
She came out a lot.
And kept going.
Where was Dell happiest?
We're reading ahead.
Actually, I'll tell you, inside the theater. That's why I asked him where he would like his ashes, and he said, I want to be in the theater affecting the work. I could have said inside me and made some sexual joke, but I wasn't going to do it.
Are you going to say you had sex with Dell?
No. That's why I didn't want to lie. My partner taught me to be honest.
If that camera wasn't there.
You're expecting Bill.
This is going
now.
Differently.
You thought it would be. So Noah, how did you meet Dell?
I took his class. When I started taking classes here, there was Charna at the Dell. So, you know, he was the level 2 teacher. So that's how I met Dell. I didn't know who he was. So there's no big story. I showed up for class that I paid for, and I was there in class. He didn't do anything crazy on the first day.
Did you did it strike you as just another class, just like Charna's, or was it something different?
It was completely different.
God, thanks, you just set him up.
No, like it was the second any kind of performance class I'd ever had was Dell's. So the first was Charna's, and most people here have taken Charna's class, or some have, and very, you know, it's very supportive, and like everybody makes breakthroughs, and everything's new, and it's great, and everyone's wonderful, and then they start to crap all over you. No, and Dell was more ruthless, I'd say, but it was a lot of fun. I enjoyed that because there were some retards in our first level class, and I just remember the first class I had. I mean, one guy showed up to class drunk and announced that he was drunk, like to Dell. He's like, "I gotta go pee. I should never drink two pitchers of beer before an act." Class or whatever, and he thought that was like a way of ingratiating himself with Dell, and he ran out of the room to pee, and Dell just went, "Oh dear, I was so hoping he wasn't going to be an asshole." You minded your P's and Q's the rest of the way through, didn't fuck around.
How many times did you take Dell? Did you take him a lot?
Well, first time I took Dell, I was at a party, and everybody was just crying. And I didn't want to be square. In those days, you just took Dell over and over again until, and you paid over and over again until, like, and you would sort of not pay the first week, and then eventually you'd pay later and later in the session, then Charna would stop asking you for money, then you'd know you'd arrived when you'd stopped paying for Dell's class, but we're still taking it. That means, like, I'm, like, part of the Improv Olympic now, because I've taken Dell's class 6 times.
Yeah, well, then people just kept taking it because they just wanted to get really good, and then eventually Dell would just say, "Yeah, I can teach you no more. Go teach other people." You know, and
he didn't say it quite like that. It was more. It was more like, "I got nothing else to teach you people."
Well, I have heard him say it like that to some people.
You could admit that you had sex with Dell.
Speaking of that, Jeff, how did you first meet Dell?
I was having sex with Charna.
Oh, good cover.
Yeah.
Sammy will just be randomly doing that.
I was working in the box office, and...
You were an intern?
Yeah, I was an intern. It was something like level 3. And someone had... we were really busy on a Saturday night, and we weren't able to answer the phone. And Charna came over from her house, because she had been answering the phones at the house.
The front line for Improv Olympic rings here and in Charna's house.
I have a home office, so
and if it rings 3 times, she answers it.
And yells at them.
Yes.
Yeah. So she came over and yelled at me for not answering the phone, and I was trying to ask her which was more important, taking the money for people to come in to watch shows. Or answering the phones, and she said both of them are equally as important, so do both. And she yelled at me for a little bit, then went upstairs, watched some shows, and when she came back down, I said, I had a message, but we were really busy. I answered the phone, but it happened so quickly, I didn't get really much of the message. It was some guy named Andy Dick, and he needs for you to call him back. I don't have a number for you to call him back. And she started yelling and screaming at me.
You're so full of crap.
No, this is true. What are you talking about?
What is it to do with Dell?
Well, he's getting to
me. Let me finish the fucking story.
I hate when you do this, because I don't remember any of these.
Well, you don't remember most of the schedules that we did either. So you yelled at me for not getting the message, and then I told you I was joking, and then you started laughing, and then 2 days later you called me and asked me if I would drive Dell around and take him to do different errands and help him out. And
I remember that. I remember that you were an intern, and Dell needed someone to take him to grocery shop and help do laundry and just do all these things that I didn't need to do. I like to have fun with Dell and go to movies and stuff like that, but I don't want to take him to grocery shopping.
So then Dell and I would go out every week. So then Dell and I would go out every week and run errands, and every once in a while we'd go see a movie or go out to eat and all of those things.
Did you have a car at the time?
I didn't have a car. When thing is, we've done this twice now.
Why didn't you tell me you didn't have a car? How am I supposed to drive him around?
Well, I borrowed cars to... We have done this interview twice before in front of people, and each time I tell the story and you don't remember it.
I don't remember you ever told me.
Do you have any interesting anecdotes about when you drove Dell around?
Yeah,
no, they're not. It's all interesting. I didn't have a car. I borrowed a car, and I would each week I came with a different car, and he thought that was hilarious. And then eventually, my dad had this real beat up old Ford truck that he gave me, and that was the truck that I drove Dell around in for a year. And then I got into a woman, made a U-turn and destroyed the truck, and I didn't have a car anymore. And Dell offered to buy me a new car.
What?
Then he died.
That's too bad. So I suppose I owe you a car.
You do. You promised when he died I would get a truck. Hey,
I'll write that down because I forget those things. Why you tell your funny story about the time that you went to Dell's house and he
I was in the supermarket and said Phil Charna.
What?
Okay, so moving on. When Dell came on board with Improv Olympic, did you think that this is going to be Improv Olympic now, or was it still as a workshop thing? When you, like you said before, Dell said, "Are you willing to shut down for a little bit and work on this?"
I totally restructured.
Yeah. How long was the shutdown period?
About 3 months.
That's a long time. Mm-hmm. And how many people were working? On this new thing.
Not many.
Were you a part of that, Noah?
No, I was not.
No. Bjorn's very cool. It's Dave Caswazy. Mm-hmm. And some of these other people that are on that team. Joel Murray and Mark Beltzman and a few other people here and there.
J.J. Johnson.
Who?
Was J.J. working on
that? Yeah, I think so. Like all the people in Bjorn Barracuda's. And not many. Because some of the people were just so into the games, they were just convinced that was it. You know, I was crazy. To change that, you know, and then and it was very hard to break everyone's idea of what, not to break it, but to convince everyone that no, improvisation can be better, we can do something cooler. Everyone else is like, oh, I've seen improv, it's games, I don't know nothing to do with it. And I go, but come see this. Even the press, it was hard to convince them this is something really cool, come see it. We're bringing improv to another level. That's why I'm so protective of improv when I see just anybody running and going to do it without taking classes, because it's fragile and it could fall apart. It can go back to that point in time where everyone thought, oh yeah, I've seen that. Now, you know. So I'm protective of it in that way, because I feel like I brought it somewhere else and it could easily just fall down again. Was that the question? Yeah.
Yeah. When eventually...
Where's our waiter?
What would you like?
Eventually, with Dell, it went from Charna, you were teaching, and then Dell, and then eventually that grew to what we have now. Five levels.
It's 21 years it took.
Yeah. Did how did that? What's the difference in the teaching, or the Harold itself? In that it used to just take two teachers, now it takes five teachers in a year.
We're just ripping people off. That's all.
I'm curious.
Well, basically.
Thank you, Mrs. Calabash, whoever you are.
No, people would stay with Dell and just keep working on different things for a real long time, so he would just handle everything that's advanced, you know? So most of the stuff that I saw Dell do over the years, because I went to all his classes too, I just started putting in levels, you know? Like, I would see him do the invocation, I would see him do, you know, the reflection scenes that I do in my first week of classes, I would see him do all these things, and I broke it up into different parts of the curriculum. You know, what Noah does, or the things that he saw Dell do in the advanced workshops. So, but then we just started thinking, okay, people need to be getting good. We need to break this up. People need to take their time now. We started getting more popular as a theater, so the work had to be better and better and better, and it has been getting better and better. I mean, I have some teams that were the greatest teams back in 1981 who come now and go, oh, shit, I could never do that, you know? So the work has gotten consistently better. And I think it's because we are saying, here, let's take a level to work on the person, you know, to get them to be a strong performer with range. Let's take some time to do some object work, which Dell never did. He never cared about it, or character, or whatever. So it just gives everybody a little bit more time, more opportunity, and just keeps the place constant movement.
And you didn't, when I started, you did not have to be good at all to get on stage. You could just be like a wet turd. Seriously. I mean, when I first started, I had no concept of how to be on a stage in front of people. I couldn't be heard from, like, for me to where Patrick is sitting.
Well, I took you up a team once for a while.
Yeah.
Because it couldn't be heard.
Sure,
but he was
did.
Brilliant. And I said, when you're ready to be heard, tell me, and then you can go
but,
back on a team.
I mean, the first way I got put on the team in the first place, the first team I was on, was I was just at every show, and I had like a six-pack in me. And Charna came up to me and said, this team Limbo Club, and they were awful. They were this team that was, they were like in the math fight thing where they were just like the crosshairs around them were torpedoing. And I said, this team needs someone to sit in with them, and they really want you. And I'm like, there's no way they even know who I am. And I was drunk the first night, and I was just like, and I was horrible.
I did that to a lot of people. Well, first of all, at that time, everybody who was in improv got on teams.
Right.
Everybody got on. I mean,
at that time, there were like 20 students in the program. Right. Now there are 200 and something people on stage and maybe 300 people in the program.
So not everybody can get on anymore. We try to do our best to give everybody performance opportunities.
But what does that have to do with Del, Charna?
Nothing.
Jeez. Nobody wants to hear about that crap. Let's
start.
Why don't we talk about, like, thong underwear? I'm just trying to steer back to Del.
Yes.
Because
I'm just letting you talk, and I didn't want to interrupt.
But Del would eventually look at somebody and go, get that person off the fucking stage.
Did you get him off the stage?
Oh, sure. Well, Del would just scream.
He was that way with people who were, established. I was in a class with a guy who'd been at the main stage in Second City for years, who, when I first came to Chicago, who was coming in to sit in on Dell's class. I'm not going to say who it is because the guy's been in the Looney Bin since. But he was like a kind of a star at Second City. And I'm on stage with him. And of course, so I assume he's the guy who knows what to do. And he walked out and said to me, his opening line in the scene was, "Ooh, now you're the mosaic." And I just looked at him like, oh. And I thought, oh, I'm so bad at improv, I suck. This master improviser has done something probably brilliant, and I feel like peeing my pants. And Del goes, excuse me. And I'm going to call him Mike, because his name wasn't Mike, it was Rick. It was not Thomas. He goes, Mike, I'm sorry, why don't you just come sit down, because you're of absolutely no help up there. I'm just like, dodged the bullet. It hit the guy next to me.
Del used to stop the class and say to the, call the person off the stage and write a check and give him back money for the class. And say, just leave, take your money. And I used to get so mad.
I believe the line that I heard quoted was, we've done you a horrible disservice by allowing you to progress this far in the program.
Yeah. But even just most recently, he was before he died, he would do that downstairs. Yeah. And I'd say, Del.
In the hospital, he did it to some of the nurses.
But I would say,
I'm sorry, we've done you a horrible disservice by allowing you to administer me. I'm going to write you a check for
seriously, he would give me the money. And there have been times that there are people who hadn't paid yet because they didn't pay the first week or they were in a payment plan, and he'd give them back $200. I go, but she didn't pay. And he's like, it's worth it to just get rid of her. And I was like, don't give me the money.
Do you think Del's teaching method, the survival of the fittest almost, like if you could survive Del, that brought out the best in people for improv?
No.
Well, first of all, let me just say, Del was also a very supportive teacher. He just, if you tried, he wasn't going to rip you to pieces. If you did something that was rude, if you didn't take a note and you were just being a total asshole or something, but most of the time it was just like a funny insult. I mean, he rarely would just tear someone apart, because most of the students would say to me, I was so scared to take Del, but he's so nice, he was great. I mean, because I remember one time he said, all right, let's have 8 people on stage, and like everyone was just frozen in their seats, and he just waited a while. well, I can't help anyone unless you get on stage, you know, and so he knew he was scary, and he really didn't.
I don't think it was a trial by fire with
him. Yeah.
I think it was more, he just assumed, well, I mean, I think Dell's basic philosophy towards students and audience members, which he stated was, treat your students and your audience as if they are poets and geniuses, because then you create the possibility that they'll rise to that occasion.
Right.
Which I believe, that's if I have anything that I've taken from Dell as a philosophy towards life, it's that. And trust me, I've taught thousands of students like poets and geniuses, and I've yet to get a genius or a poet. but at least the possibility is there.
Right.
And it wasn't like who's good and they're going to rise above it. He wasn't into that at all.
Right.
That's a misunderstanding about Dell.
He would even take a misfit of somebody who wasn't great,
Frank
or who
Kendra,
even tried.
For
huh?
sake.
Yeah, or Keith. You know, I mean, and he would be appreciative of something if they tried.
See, Frank Kendra's dead, but Keith is probably here.
But it's his last name, like he didn't know. But oh Jesus.
Go ahead.
But he would be grateful if they tried hard, right. And he would be, you know, supportive. But yeah, if it was somebody who wasn't trying or who was lying on stage, he wanted you to be honest. He wanted you to be the best you can be and not try to be lame. And he would say that. And then if they went up and did that and tried to be funny, he'd go, get off the stage, turkey. You know, and so things like that would happen once in a while. But most often he was a very good support teacher and a good teacher because everything he said was right. That's the thing. And so you learned a lot.
Everything that wasn't right. Everything he said was true.
Right.
There's a huge difference.
Well,
I heard tons of really bad stories about him before I had him, and I guess I thought that he mellowed quite a bit by the time I got him, because we had one instance where a girl was playing it for laughs and he got after her and asked her if she thought she was funny because nobody else did. But that was the meanest thing that I had heard from him. Everything else he was really supportive. I don't know that he was always right.
Like when?
Well, he did a show. He did a show that I didn't particularly care for, and I was in it, and he and I talked about it. Called Sex Wars.
Mm-hmm.
And he and I talked about it, and I said, I think all this show is a show for you to get women to say horrible, dirty things, and for the men to degrade the women. And he said, might be, and it's fun to watch. And there was a lot of...
This takes us to the second part.
There was good things improv-wise going on, but what he was doing for the show was putting across his personal views of women and marriage, which was something that he was not exactly
I watched for. That show, and the best one in it was Bridget. She was strong and powerful, and she knew... But to show you how dark Dell was, should you run a little monologue?
Sure.
Show you his unique point of view, okay? This is one of my favorite monologues I picked for you tonight. You got it?
The opportunity to go to the bed.
You want a little bit?
No.
Okay. Thank you.
The duct tape.
Speaking to you from on board a nuclear submarine somewhere deep in Lake Geneva. I'd like to speak tonight to any of you viewers who happen to be dying. Now, there's 2 or 3 million of them out there. That's the size of a major American city. There's got to be some people dying. Now, why you're watching this program, I have no idea. Really, instead of something inspirational, you know, they really ought to have a death channel for people that are on their way out. A lot of nostalgia, nifty music, pretty pictures, kind of like Edward G. Robinson got in Soylent Green. Now, the thing about death is, and I've died a couple of times, so I'm speaking from experience, is that when you finally get around to it, it's very satisfying. It's kind of like resolving an atomic chord on a piano. And in the words of the great Chicago poet, Ken Nordine, death is nature's way of telling us to slow down. But the hardest part about dying, the truly hardest part, is all the terrible television we have to watch. Because once they get you into intensive care, you can't deal with the television set anymore. You can't reach the channel changer. Who controls the TV? The nurses control the TV. And what do they want to watch? They're stupid, boring soap operas all the time. And they leave all the sets on the ward tuned to the same channel so they won't miss a beat as they're going from room to room, bothering people. Okay, all you people out there who are dying, to you, I want to say this. On behalf of everyone on Earth, those people you've met and those you haven't met, thank you for taking this trip with us. Thank you for sharing this planet. Didn't we have a time? Go on. Go gentle into that good night. Don't rage against the dying of the light. And as they say in that inspirational movie, Simon, King of the Witches, remember, death is only temporary. I'll see you around. Whatever you want to adjust, see if I care. This is Ozymandias. Once again, and I bring you a message of hope. Norman Cousins has got a new book out, and it's called Hit First, The Biology of Hope. And it's about holistic medicine and about the power of the human mind and spirit to conquer disease. I'm for that. I'm for anything that puts the screws to the medical establishment. Yeah, go get them. Now, Norman Cousins' previous book was called The Anatomy of an Illness. And what that was about how he cured his leukemia by watching Buster Keaton movies, Marx Brothers movies, Laurel and Hardy movies, in his highest hospital, and he was laughing. He cured his leukemia through laughter. Ahoy there, Catholic Church. Are we paying attention here? You know, I think we got some major miracle action on our hands. I mean, if the flickering shadows of dead comedians on the wall of a hospital room can cure cancer, I mean, isn't time we started talking about a little sainthood? St. Stan, St. Ollie, the chapel of St. Curly, and the blessed St. Gummo. Now, I know the Stooges and the Marx Brothers were Jewish, but how about a little ecclesiastical affirmative action here? I mean, so what if they're Jewish? St. Josephat was the Buddha. St. Veronica was just a veil. And Pope Joan was a woman, for heaven's sakes. Oh, let Mother Teresa wait. I mean, she's not very funny anyway. So no matter what you think about Andrew Dice Clay, he's cheap, he's sleazy, he's sexist, he's dumb. If he's out there getting laughs, he may be doing God's work. Ho, ho, ho.
Going back to class for a second, Jeff, you were his intern for level 3?
Yeah, level 3 through 5B, and then like 7 or 8 months after that.
Mm-hmm. So you were his intern while he was your teacher. Did that affect your relationship at all?
No, he, if anything, was a little harder on me than because he knew my name, and I was one of the only people in my class who knew my name. So he would be a little harder on me, but he wouldn't show any type of favoritism. And he and I were good friends, and it sort of taught me how to be friends with people that I coach or people that I teach, and then go about teaching them or coaching them. So I learned that from him, which is cool.
See, one of my favorite Delco stories. This is something that Dell actually told me. Before I moved Dell into a nice apartment away from Second City, where it was roach infested, before I got him into his apartment, he didn't have the best health habits, and his house was a mess, and there were roaches everywhere. It was just awful. And he was doing a show at the Goodman. No, there was a party at the Goodman. It was a Tennessee Williams play, and Tennessee Williams was actually a guest there and with Dell, because Dell was in it. And, you know, all these old ladies, the blue hairs, Dell used to call them, who were donating money to the Goodman and stuff. And Dell was with Tennessee Williams, and I think it was Greg Mosher, who was the director at the time. And Dell was shaking a woman's hand, and a cockroach crawled out from under his cuff onto her white glove. And she screamed and ran away, and Tennessee Williams looked at Dell and said, "Boy, I like your style." So many crazy stories about Dell like that. You know, every movie star, somebody famous used to get high with Timothy Leary. Huh?
What year did that happen?
I don't know what year it was. It was before he met me.
Oh, okay. I was just checking if we were there.
I wasn't at there.
Okay.
It was only Dell's story.
There's a weird Dell thing that happens at the Goodman now, in that people, theater students who go to the Goodman, do research on the Goodman, then ask to see the skull.
Really?
And they can't because it's in Robert Falls' office, and it's on a shelving unit right behind his desk. So if Robert Falls is sitting here having a meeting with you, the skull is right here. And a lot of people don't know who or what Dell is or why there's a skull there. And it's very obviously a human skull. It's not like a plaster thing. A lot of people ask him to drape it or move it during the meeting, and Robert Falls won't.
Aiden Quinton told me that he went to the office and he got to touch the skull, and he did a Hamlet soliloquy. Just for fun, because he was Hamlet with Dell. That showed that Dell was colonial, so it was kind of nice. I'm trying to think of other fun stories about Dell.
I have some questions.
Okay, good.
Okay. Noah, you were directed by Dell? Or coached for a team? Not coached per se.
No.
Let me think of a funny story.
But under his artistic director, you were on one of the teams here. How do you think that was different? Like, did you guys have a coach on Barons Barracudas?
I was not Barons
Barracudas. On the here in the picture.
No, he's not.
No, that's not me. That's Steve Burrows.
Yeah.
Really?
But yo, I remember those days. No, they were like the house team when I started taking classes. I wasn't on that team.
But he was like the coach of that team, yeah, because he was one. That was the first team that we had. So you can call that squeeze if you want.
Yeah, could you? Tell that hand story.
This one?
Do you think we should? Okay.
Yeah.
It's very scary. Oh, geez. You don't want me to tell the story. Okay. This is, All right. Because I don't want you to get the wrong impression that Dell's crazy or something, but, you know, Dell was in touch.
You've given them such a mishmash of an impression so far. What the hell can we do now?
Well, even though we weren't having sex a long time ago, when we were very poor, whenever we traveled, we'd share hotel rooms, of course, sleep in twin beds.
Oh!
and we'd travel and do workshops all over the country and stuff, and we went, actually Second City hired us to do a workshop at Second City in Canada. And it was our first trip together, and we shared a hotel room. And one night, I was asleep, and I turned over, and I looked at him in his bed, and he was laying on his back, and his hands were doing the scene, moving around. I figured, you know, Dell was a witch. He was into witchcraft. And so I thought maybe he's doing some ritual, or maybe he's getting some flashbacks. You know, he did so much acid, and he was like, who knows what he's doing. So I just ignored it. It was none of my business, and I went back to sleep. And then about a year later, he got a job directing a show in New York. And he had me fly out to visit him for a few days, and they had this really nice apartment with like a little studio thing with a bedroom and a little living room and stuff. And I was in, again, at night in bed, and I was in my bed, and I turned around, and I see his hands moving around. And I thought, oh yeah, I remember that. He was doing that a while ago. And then the next morning, he got up early, and he was watching TV in the living room, and he was asleep, and his back was to the bedroom door, so when I came out of the bedroom, his hand was moving around over his shoulder. And it went like this to me and waved at me. So I said, oh, good morning. And then all of a sudden, he woke up as if he was asleep. He had just waved to me. So I thought that was kind of strange. He was like, oh, good morning. So I thought, I didn't know exactly what was going on, but I didn't think too much of it, really. Then that night, back in bed again, I'm asleep and I turn over and his hands are going like this, and all of a sudden, like, pretend Noah is me in that bed, and I'm, the hands are going like this, and shut up, Noah. And all of a sudden the hands stop and they go like this, and they come up to me and go, "You're dead. You're dead." And I woke up and I was like, "What the hell is going on? Your hands are telling me I'm dead." And he's like, "Don't worry about it, don't worry about it."
You called me from New York.
I was very scared. Well, first I asked him, I said, "What's going on?" He goes, "They don't want to talk about it." So I called Noah. I called Noah and I said, "Do you think Dell would kill me?"
I said, "Well, he's a genius."
And Noah said that he didn't think he would harm me. And like, of course, he didn't know. He was just saying, "Don't worry about it. Just go back to sleep."
It was like 4 in the morning or something.
Wow. I was scared. How would you feel? Anyway.
"Do you think Dell would kill me?" On a dare?
Again, the next day I tried to get him to tell me about it, and he would not tell me about it. So that's all I really know. But Laura Kraft used to live downstairs with him in this apartment near my house, and she used to hear him yelling things at night, to which I think are the hands talking in his sleep.
And she used to hear him yell "nigger" at the TV.
It's just his hands.
His hands are so racist.
To this day what to make of it, because he wouldn't tell me. I think there might have been maybe a little schizophrenia there or something, but I think he was a really brilliant man, and there were these different sides of his brain that were
like that guy in the X-Files who was like, he had that cancer in his head but he knew everything.
I didn't see that show.
Do you think there's a possibility that it might be that he was fucking around with you?
No. He because wasn't, this like, a whole year. He was like, he was going to wait that long for a practical joke.
You don't think that it could have been him playing a joke?
No.
On you?
I was sound asleep. It was like 3 or 4 in the morning. No, he was asleep. And in fact, I made him stay up so I could go back to sleep because he said, "It's nothing. I'm in control." And I said, "Well, I'm not going back to sleep with your hands walking around like that." So he stayed up, he turned on the lamp and he read while I went back to sleep. I really didn't. I had my eyes open like the whole time.
So you weren't afraid of Dell, you were more afraid of the hands.
Right. That was definitely, they had a whole brain, like that hand waved to me in the morning. It was like waving to me, and then it turned to me and it was like, looking at me like, it was like Garfield.
You couldn't control that if you were awake.
No, what I'm saying is, it was very clear to me from the few times I observed this that when he was asleep, his hands would move around in the air of their own volition. And they didn't like me for some reason. I was dead. I don't know. Maybe I was onto their secret. I have no idea. I'm just telling you the story, guys.
Jeff, I'd like you to tell us the story of the time you went to go pick up Dale.
Yeah. Stop that.
The
one you thought you were
doing. He was watching that movie I haven't seen.
Yeah. Repo Man?
Repo Man.
Yeah.
It's a good movie.
Yeah, I just went over to go pick him up. We had to go to the bank and run to the grocery store and get some things for him. And he, I knocked on the door. I buzzed. He buzzed me up. I went, walked in. He never talked to me. He sat down. He had, I don't know what it is because I don't know anything about pot, but he had this thing that he was smoking out of. And he was smoking out of it.
The bong?
I guess so. It was a little...
You don't know what a bong is?
No, I don't... Come on. I don't know. So, he was...
Okay.
It was it was like this big. It was really small.
Okay. It was a pipe.
Sure. I guess. And he was smoking out of that and putting it back down. And I talked to him a couple times, and we just sat there and we were watching the movie, and... finished watching Repo Man, and I thought, well, we're getting ready to go here pretty quick. And then he got up, looked like he was getting ready to go, and then Raising Arizona came on, so he said, oh, I'll have to watch this. And sat down, and we watched all of Raising Arizona. And then I said, Del, we've got to go. And when I reached for him and grabbed him, he jumped, and I go, what's the matter with you? And he said, holy Jesus, I thought you were my cat. And I said, I've been here for almost 4 hours, and I've been having conversations with you about this movie and the movie before that. We've been talking for 4 hours. And he said, you would be amazed at the conversations I've had with that cat.
And that's totally dull. It's totally dull.
Camera was not me.
Okay. It was.
In the time that I started taking classes, there were, when I first started, there were 3 levels. 1, 2, and then down.
Who was the second one?
Miles.
Oh, okay.
And then a 4th was added, then a 5th was added for down. Of course, also when I first started, pretty much you'd have to be actually life-threatening or maiming people to not get on a team. So in that time, it exploded. The amount of teams, the amount of people in classes. Did Dell's opinion of people coming to class change? Did Dell see teams and like or dislike how he saw things?
Dell was never a really big watcher, even when we started the shows themselves. I mean, he was mostly into the classes. Uh-huh. And then if he put something up, he'd watch the first one, and he had that light diffusion run philosophy of directing. But he was not really into watching the shows.
Not lately. At Crosscurrents, he was.
When I started, he wasn't into it.
Oh, really?
It was like a big deal if Del watched the show. Yeah. And I started, Eisenhower was president.
I never saw him watch a show downstairs. The only time I ever did was a particular time when...
he watched his level 5 shows.
Yeah, but not the show is downstairs.
No, he was here on the weekends.
For Spoo and Lindbergh Babies, he was here pretty much most of the time. But it was to watch, not to give notes or anything. But the only time I ever saw him downstairs to watch a show, he told me he was coming, was to watch Baby Bucks Candy, when you asked him to watch Baby Bucks Candy. But that's the only time
I just know over the years, since I worked with him for 19 years, he did watch shows, and after a while he just couldn't do it anymore. Don't forget, he directed Second City for 12 years. So he watched a lot of improv there, and a lot of, so after a while he just got burned out on watching it,
And the Herald was kind of something he had moved on from.
Yeah, he felt like he had completed that mission.
Sure. I mean, even in the days of Baroness Barracudas, which was the first Herald team, he sort of launched them and they moved beyond what they gave him. I mean, when I first started, Dave Vasquez used to say, we do this work. We do more of this work than Del ever did. He just set us afloat on it, and that wasn't meant as a diss. It was, it's not this finite thing. The Herald is this way. It was like he sort of sets you a seed to go out to greener pastures.
But when the family was here, which was another major team for him, he directed 2 shows with them. And he watched their shows and would give notes afterwards and try to make it work. And then when it worked, like Noah said, he felt his job was done.
I mean, their description of working with him is not him telling them what to do. It's him sort of like giving them things and then sort of retreating and them figuring out how to do it. Not a hands-on situation at all. I mean, Miles describes family rehearsals as Del telling them something sort of heady at the beginning of rehearsal and going and lying down on the table and sleeping while they argue about it for a couple hours and work it out, and they go, I think we got it, Del. You know, and he's like, I was dreaming about killing Charna.
Why did you wake me? Please.
But other than when he directed shows, he was a completely different guy in terms of directing a show, because I think he had a professional's view of a scripted show, but I think he really saw what we do as something that you don't create a box, you create a springboard. And,
right.
You know, let
as
it
a director,
go.
He was
let
like, his job is to inspire you as a director.
And that's what I enjoyed about his workshops, frankly, was I wasn't there to learn technique. And I think I was there to be inspired. And it was like, this week, we're going to do a long form based on, you know, the bugs in my apartment kind of thing. And literally, and how they seem to have this pecking order between the roaches and the ants and my cat. And, you know, how could we create that improvisationally? Or, you know, and you spent 3 hours on that. He would do something like, italics. Can we improvise italics?
Oh, yeah.
What? and he says, exactly. And
what?
Exactly.
Yeah, I remember
italics?
That episode.
When you say italics, what do you mean? And then more things like that. And
it came
like,
out with something he had read that
sure.
inspired him to launch the workshop that night. And so there'd be this little diatribe about it. And then
the Lindbergh Babies was based off of pop-up videos.
Yeah. He would always come into our class and he would speak just almost exactly 29 minutes, almost 31 minutes. It was always one in between that range. And I always marveled because he sat with
and
his...
apparently you also timed it.
Well, because I was about, he had, there was a digital clock in the light booth downstairs facing out so teams could see it. And he would sit just near underneath the booth and I would sit watching him and I'd go, okay, 7 o'clock. And I'd watch him and he'd go, all right. Let's get on stage. And I was like, how does he do that? He wouldn't look at his watch or anything. But my favorite, he came in overjoyed one time because he had gotten a letter back from the Animaniacs. He had written them saying, I saw your Christmas special. It was absolutely delightful.
I don't know what the Animaniacs are.
It's a hilarious cartoon.
I'm sorry. I'm a retard.
So he, no, he wrote
anything
them a letter.
Happened in the last 15 years.
He wrote them a letter saying how much he liked that, well, first he described several episodes of the Animaniacs source, but then on the Christmas episode of the Animaniacs, I believe Yakko, who speaks like Ringo Starr, is playing the drums in front of a Christmas tree and floats up in the air, and for just the briefest second becomes Ringo, floats back down and becomes Yakko again. And he said, I thought that was a wonderful transformation of Yakko into his avatar, Ringo Starr. So let's do a form about avatars. And we'd go on stage, and he'd be like, well, I didn't see that coming. We just talked about 20 minutes of the Animaniacs. And he got back the creator of the Animaniacs, whose name eludes me at the moment. He hand-drew a card for Dell, because he had heard about, never met Dell, but had heard about him, because he's a Dell close in Papa Limbic. And it sounded familiar. I know this because it was in the letter that he wrote back to Dell. And in the card, he had hand-drew that scene for Dell and said, Merry Christmas, Dell. And Dell didn't like the Merry Christmas part, but he said, Merry Christmas. And then just put the gate, he brought it. He was like a kid because he brought it and he goes, look what I got. And he showed it to us and then we did a form on avatars. That was my Dell story.
No, that's the kind of stuff that's he did. He would have something.
Yeah, I think we'd get caught up, some prepositional phrase. We get caught up in what Dell invented, and I think what Dell inspired is far more interesting. That he would realize that what we're doing is an art form, and as such, if it starts to get like insular, it gets boring, like game shows, you know, improv game shows, not game shows, which are never boring. boring. But that he would just walk in with something that he just thought was interesting in the world. And here's something where it's usually dull, like Animaniacs, no offense to the Animaniacs fans, that at this day transcended what they did with some little flower of inspiration. Why don't we constantly do that and bring that to what we do as if we are a canvas rather than a paint-by-numbers set? Which he didn't. He didn't teach much form. I mean, he invented some form, but who cares? I mean, every 5B show invents a form. What he did was tell you to bring, okay, this is a medium through which you feel you can express yourself, and here are some things that kind of inspired me in the last week. What has inspired you guys? And it might be anything from the way you know, network news anchors talk to their, through their things, to the marginalia in Mad Magazine, to animaniacs rising in the air to find their avatar. All the stuff that's bullshit in its own form kind of works in improv. To just say, you know, just keep expanding that and finding new stuff and believing that this is an art form rather than this is my art form and it works this way.
Right, and more than just inventing the Herald, as Noah said, he was more interested in what a group can do, what the group mind can do, the theory that the intelligence of the group is raised because of people together rather than being lowered, which really is what usually would happen with large groups, and, you know, what we can create is, you know, with the group mind. And he also was very happy that he felt his contribution was that we created theater of the heart, where people cherish each other on stage in order to succeed rather than screwing each other on stage and taking care of each other. And that's what he felt his big contribution was. And yeah, he didn't have that worry about the games. Or he felt that long form just ate short form. Everything, there shouldn't be this battle between long form and short form. You can still do these things within this long form context that's just more challenging to bring things together and have you work together as a group. So I agree with what you're saying as far as it isn't just about the Herald, it's about what people can do as a group together, how we can become this genius brain on stage. That's what was interesting to him.
And he was trying all kinds of new things with his 5B, just trying to do something different, try to do all kinds of different things.
And that's why he'd always say, play at the top of your intelligence. Please, don't try to be stupid. We don't have time for that. Know what you know. Bring something to the work. Read. Challenge yourselves. Make art, be a poet, be a genius.
That was the thing that was really fun for me about Doubt, not to digress, was that he was a student of everything. He was a true Renaissance man in the old school Florentine sense, in that he would walk into class having read a fucking tome about, the way the brain works is now controversial because doctors are arguing whether it works like an electronic process or a chemical process like a gland. And can we use that in our improv? And it'd be like, well, the audience is going to love that. but he would talk about it in a way that was like he was passionate about it. It wasn't about how can we improvise in a way that's more like Saturday Night Live?
Right.
Or how can we recreate the sitcom mystique on the stage?
He even did an exercise to dull the one side of the brain. Remember, he had people sit.
I don't know if that was an exercise or a pill.
No. It was an exercise that actually did work. It made something cool. It became this ritual. But first, he just made us sit in a circle and hum because he wanted to dull the left side of the brain so that the right side could take over, and that's what was the creative side of the brain. So first we had to like put this side of the brain to sleep and let something happen, and it was like all these really interesting experiments. You know, he's like this mad scientist. He really was.
And he went, while he had those incredibly smart things that he loved, he also loved like Repo Man and South Park.
He was a sucker for fart jokes.
Yeah.
he put fart jokes in that raunchy. He was hired to direct this thing that never got off the launch pad.
At the time I was in New York.
Tony Handra, who here has seen Spinal Tap, the movie? The guy who plays like their manager who walks around with a cricket bat, right? And it's an affectation. You know what I'm talking about? Oh, for crap's sake. His name is he's Tony Handra, and he's an English guy, and he was he wrote this like trashing of the Reagan era called Ron Giovanni as like a comedy musical spoof that was going to be at the Lincoln Center, and Del was hired to direct it, and the thing was just a doomed project from day one. I mean, Del wanted Bill Murray didn't want to do it, so we got Bruce Jarcho. So already we know the arc of this project. And I just remember Del coming back and he had some hilarious joke of Reagan in the bathroom farting, and I was just like, oh my God. and it would talk about the bits that he'd have to argue about the producers, right? Yeah, and there were full page ads in magazines for that thing. but it never got off the ground.
But he wouldn't want anyone doing fart jokes on the stage or anything like that. I mean, I, right, I don't know.
I'm not Charna. I'm not promoting fart jokes.
Thank God.
He much preferred a cunt joke to a fart joke. But
I had him in class. He spent a good hour and a half one day talking about Carrie Wood. He just got impressed with Carrie Wood striking out 20 people in a baseball game. And spent an hour and a half talking about that one class. He had all kinds of stuff.
He canceled classes for Bears
games in like 85, 86, and they were going to the Super Bowl because he had met Gary Fensick, the gay defensive back from the World Championship Bears, who he and Gary Fensick had been backstage together at some play and got to talking, and Gary wanted to talk about the play, and Dell wanted to talk about the Bears beating Dallas 44-0, and how did they do that? Because Dallas was like the Uber team at the time. They were like the Jungenkvex Hitler team of America. And the Bears just destroyed them, and Gary Fensick told him, well, it was like we all were out there, and we knew what everybody else was doing without looking at them. We were in this state of flow. And Dell was like, yeah, that's what we kind of are in group improv. And they wound up becoming friends. And so Dell went and bought Larry Bird's book, which describes the basketball court as a shoebox-shaped, you know, holograph where Larry knew where everyone was. It's like, yeah, Larry Bird knew anything other than where his mustache was and where the hoop was. But just the idea of this sense of being outside of yourself in a group situation where you give over to that and trust that your intelligence doesn't abandon you when you stop thinking about it. Which is what trips up improvisers so often, because we've gotten a lot cleverer as improvisers, and we walk in thinking we know everything. And really, if we know anything about Socrates, we know absolutely nothing. Anyway.
He also, book-wise, recommended Phil Jackson's book to me.
Me too, I love that book. He had books like from floor to ceiling all over his apartment. He was an amazing book collector, and he's read everything. And if you mention any subject, he could know just where to go and get something on that book. And then he would have another book to back it up. And then before you read that, you have to read this. And if you went to visit Dell, you'd have to walk out of the house with like a million books. It was just so much fun to go there and just, but you had to bring him back.
Actually, when I would drive him around, we would go to the same places every week. We'd always go to the bank. We'd go to the grocery store, and then it would vary to other places that he might want to go. And I've devised a route that would keep us away from any sort of old bookstore. Because if we passed any, he would make me pull over. We'd spend an hour in there, and the bank would be closed, and we wouldn't be able to get money or anything. So I would go all the way around all the bookstores, because he'd love them.
That was his thing, his books.
His books. That was his thing.
Packing him up to move. It was like picking up the Chicago
library. I knew that how his love for books and his affection for comic books, and I didn't know until after he passed away that Dale was huge into Japanese anime. Mm-hmm. He loved it. He had tapes and tapes.
Belgian
tapes.
Anime.
Belgian anime. it's very bad. It's all about waffles. Not only did he have transforming, he had tapes and tapes and tapes of anime, but he also had the toys, and there's a few of them up there still. But I had no idea. It's something he would never bring up in conversation. It's just one of these weird facets of his.
People are starting to leave. Should we ask for a question?
Oh, yeah,
that's just
a question.
That's
just going to get to the way. Who's
that was debate.
Jeff having sex with Dell.
Or Charna having sex with Dell, having sex with Jeff.
Anything?
Or Jeff.
Do you want to just
Mike?
Is there something that he wanted to do, either personally or professionally, that he never got to do?
Well, after he saw Katarina Witt, he wanted to get a gold medal as a figure skater. Seriously.
No, seriously.
He came to class all hopped up on Katarina Witt after the Calgary one. He hated Debbie Thomas, whoever the American one was, I thought it was like Katarina Witt was just some transcendent goddess, and he talked about her. We didn't even get to play in class that day, because he talked the entire class about Katarina Witt, about this work of art that she was, and I'd never heard him speak highly of a woman before that, so
Anyway. As far as I know, all he really wanted to do was act, continue acting. That was really what he loved. More plays.
Dad.
Yes.
Kilroy.
I understand that in the days when Dell was still teaching and people were still able to take Dell's classes, they said they spent a lot of time listening to him tell stories. And he had that time because you had more levels to do a class with him. How do you think things have changed since as far as, like, obviously class size has grown incredibly and there are more classes. Do you think as a result there's any sort of watering down or loss of direction? Mostly to Charna. The Charna would be the one who would have been there.
I'm not sure exactly what the question is.
But I think Dan wants to know whether teachers should be allowed to tell longer stories
than in classes. I'm hoping that, no, I think that Dell is the only teacher that should have been allowed to tell long stories.
That's not my question.
Okay.
That's Noah's fourth beer. Do you think that as a result of you guys, Dell having this thing that he carried over from his early days, and you guys getting together and putting it together, and then teaching other people how to teach, and a teacher teaching a teacher how to teach, that there is any loss of, like, a Xerox of a Xerox of a Xerox?
I'm hoping not. I mean, we still have people here who have studied with Dell directly. In L.A., I worry about it because it's kind of like some things are passed down, and sometimes I see things not totally right. Or I hear somebody's taking some of Dell's words and not getting them exactly right, you know, and that kind of worries me. So I try to just keep my best people that are performing teaching because I feel that at least they know what they're doing, so they can pass that down. But I'm hoping to try to keep his words alive and his teachings alive. And
I would have a slightly different answer than Charna, but in agreement with Charna. I think that trying to keep his words intact becomes like a telephone game a little bit. And I think Dell trusted us with the work, and we should trust each other with it, and it has grown and changed really since Dell has died, usually. Amazing talents come through this room. I have the great privilege of teaching people at the end of the program. And some of them are, you know, just have learned stuff and are doing decent work. And I see some incredibly talented people with incredible ideas. And the last thing I want to tell them is, wait, you're not doing that right. That people like a Miles Stroff, a T.J. Jagodowski, a Dan Beckedahl, a Paul Grandi, a John Lutz, who were all students at one time learning the same stuff, all could probably write their own philosophy of improv that would affect a lot of people positively. And to me, that is a direct blossom off of Dell's vision. Not Dell as a guru, Dell's a teacher. Dell's a fountain. And you know, we could argue about this to the end of time, but I think when I see people who are just, when I walk in on a Wednesday and I see Dave Pasquese, who goes back to the very beginning of this, and TJ, who walked into Dell's class and didn't dig it, so he didn't take it, but had an incredible talent, and the two of them, what they come together and do, is based in agreement, and based in truth, and based in what we teach. We teach some technique, and that's all fine and good, but the truth that they do is really infecting. And so I think that I forgot what I was talking about.
Well, I think it's based on what you said before. Dell was, again, as Noah said earlier, based on inspiration. And he felt if you inspired other directors to take the work and do something, you did a good job. So I think that in that respect, we're still doing what Dell wants
yeah,
to do.
Yeah, and it made sense.
Yeah.
I understood.
I know, I was kidding when I said I forgot what I was talking
about. Oh, you're only your third.
And I.
You talk about Dell writing, like, I know, you know, we have, like, Truth and Comedy, but, I mean, is there other stuff that he's written that's just...
Actually, I wrote Truth and Comedy. Dell wrote one chapter on that, because he didn't want to write it. He felt like it was like writing a religion, and he didn't have an interest in doing it. Did he have any other writing? No. He wanted to write a book someday, but that wasn't his book.
He did write remember we found in that old leather briefcase, the Dell's, someone, Dell had written down or dictated
different
some.
Briefcase. I was thinking of the pictures.
Yeah. It was called Dell's Notes on the House, and it was something he had dictated in class, or he had written and given.
I hear probably
so it's typewritten, and it's actually just a sheet of paper in his notebook that said Dell's Notes on the Herald, and it's like 15, and then there's a space, and then there's 1 through 5 again, and there's no explanation.
I have a lot of things in his written, you know, notebooks and stuff, and the whole piece, like this 15-page thing of the disintegration of Dell and stuff, but he hasn't written his book or his autobiography. He never did that, really. There's a lot of writing about him, a lot of books to read about him.
I actually think that's one of the great losses that we have of Dell dying young for Dell, is that Dell never sat down and wrote a book about just being Dell.
Yeah.
Because he was always caught up in being, he was always facilitating something, and it would have been really dull for him to write, you know, here's the recipe for the Herald or something like that, which he'd taught a million times. But for Dell just sit down and write a book about what he thought about what he did would have been great. But at the time in life when old men do that, Dell was dying because he smoked his whole life. Mm-hmm. And of all the shit he did to himself, and I don't mean to be a preacher here, the one that really killed him big time was smoking.
Yeah.
I mean, he collapsed his lungs to the point where at the end of the time we knew him, he couldn't breathe and he couldn't really think. I mean, he had little moments of clarity. And
in the last few days.
And while it's all a party, I don't mean to be a preacher here, but I think one of the greatest tragedies that we missed from Dell was Dell having an afterlife, if you will, to just write some shit down. Because he always really wanted to be remembered for something specific, so we tie his name to he invented this and he created this and that, kind of like, you know, Monet and Impressionism. But I think it would have been really interesting for Dell to have had those last 20 years.
And he thought about, like, doing an Improvisers studio and taping him and getting everything done. And he used to say, too, it's funny because he used to do a lot of drugs. He shot heroin, speed, he was into cocaine and alcohol, and he beat all those things, and the one thing he couldn't beat was tobacco. And that's the thing that killed him. And he always said the tobacco was the most dangerous drug.
Truth.
I'm going to move the I'm gonna wrap things up now. There's a few people I need to thank first. Kirk Yakowski and Ali Fadanakian, who invented Inside the Improviser Studio, and we'll be doing another edition soon. I, of course, want to thank our three panelists today. Please don't leave yet. Noah, Jeff, and Charna, thank you very much. You give them a round of applause. And I think, in a way, Dell did write a book, and this is going to sound really, for lack of a better term, gay. In that each of us, if you continue doing this work and you believe in it and you're honest to yourself and the stage and the other people you share the stage with, that's the book Dell is still writing, even though he's been dead for years. I'm going to ask Jeff to close us out with the story when you took Dell to Navy Pier in the fall. Do you remember that? I know them better than Jeff.
Yeah,
he asked you to take, it was the fall, so he asked you to take...
To ride down Lakeshore Drive?
Yeah.
Yeah, he called me and asked me if all he wanted to do was take a drive down Lakeshore Drive in the fall before he died. He didn't know he was going to die. But he talked about it all the time. And he said, I told him, well, you know, I have this truck. And it's illegal to take a truck on Lakeshore Drive. He said, I'll pay for the fine. So we got into the truck, and he wanted to drive slow so we could see how the leaves had changed and just look at the lake as it was shimmering. And it was a gorgeous day, and see the trees and the lake and the beach and see the view of it with the skyscrapers and everything off the side. And we drove down, and he got a little misty and just kept looking at it, and I just pulled off when we got downtown, and I asked him if he wanted to turn around and see it again, and he said, well, that'll do until I die. And then a couple months later he died.
Thank you, Del Close, and thank you all for coming inside the Improviser Studio. Have a good night.